You're listening to the Vol Basketball Fever Podcast, your source for news, discussion, and debates about the Vols and Lady Vols basketball programs. We're available on Apple Podcasts, Spotify, Google Podcasts, and everywhere else podcasts are found. Hello, everyone, and welcome in to an episode of the Lady Vol Basketball Fever Podcast. I'm Nathanael Rutherford. I'm joined by a special guest this week, Kellyanne Stitts of WATE6. Before we get into that, if you guys are listening on audio, if you're listening to Apple Podcasts, Spotify, wherever you listen to the regular podcast, stop right now. Go check our YouTube channel because we're actually live on video here. It's not just any graphics overlaid on audio. You can see me and Kellyanne here on the screen. So go check it out. Go subscribe to our YouTube channel while you're there as well. And go like our videos, share them around. We'll have a lot more video content coming. But again, this is the Lady Vol Basketball Fever Podcast. Very excited to have you on, Kellyanne. Thank you so much.
Oh, I'm excited to be here. Thank you for having me on.
Yeah, absolutely. So I wanted to get you on. We've had a couple of different guest hosts come on and join me and correspondents for the Lady Vol Podcast. So feel free to, before we get really into it here, let our listeners or our viewers here know a little bit about you.
Yes, so I'm a sports reporter and anchor at WATE-TV. It's the ABC affiliate here in Knoxville, Tennessee. I've been here for almost 2 years now, which is crazy, but cover everything Tennessee athletics, of course, our high school teams as well, talking some Titans here and there and some of our pro teams and just anything that happens nationally with sports, but really locked in to, of course, the Lady Vols. I've had the pleasure of covering them for now, like I mentioned, a year and a half, and this team, this season is super impressive. Of course, years past, since Kelly has taken over the program, I feel like they've continued to be on the rise. Since I've been here, I've seen that progress. And they're off to their best start of her head coaching career, 9-0 right now, without Rae Burrell, which to me is extremely impressive.
Yeah, that to me has been the most impressive part. Not even that they're 9-0, and you look at some of the wins they've had, it's been against some really good competition. But the fact they've done it without Rae, like that's been the most impressive part. You've seen Jordan Horston really step up and be a leader and take over. But you also seen the past couple games, you've seen freshmen like Sarah Puckett and Brooklyn Miles step up. So, I mean, it's been, you've seen a lot of players really step up into roles when they've really needed to this season.
Yes, and I want to go back to not just without Rae Burrell, but what's impressive to me is we look back even from last season, and yes, they're facing different opponents, but I believe from when I looked in the last, comparing their schedules from this year and last year, from this point in the season, they've beaten more ranked opponents. And last year, of course, they had Renia Davis. So they have a three-headed monster with Renia Davis, Rae Burrell, and Jordan Horston. And of course, Jordan has continued to elevate her game this year. Tamari Key is incredible. She has been awesome on both ends of the court too this season, which I think has also been key into why this team has been so good. But you mentioned that freshman class. They're also really impressive. Sarah Puckett, she's not playing like a freshman. Mm-hmm. And last game was a really good feel-good game because Brooklyn Miles had a career game. She was SEC Freshman of the Week this week. And then multiple of them continue to step up and elevate their game. And I think that's really important to have that. This freshman class has been truly impressive.
No, they have. And they were a class who I thought could, you know, make immediate contributions, but I wasn't expecting necessarily maybe this to this degree so far. Again, we'll see what happens. You know, we're going to see them play Stanford this weekend. We're going to see in the SEC schedule here very soon. It's not like Bloody Vols have had a soft, easy schedule to begin with anyway. They've played Texas, playing UCF, USF, and of course, Oklahoma State, Kansas, like, and they've obviously won all those games, and a lot of it's been based on their defense. Kellyanne, you know, we've already mentioned the fact that they've done all this basically with Rae Burrell playing like 17 minutes so far this season. I think that's easily, to me, the most impressive thing. But aside from that, what has been the most impressive thing to you for watching this team this season, besides playing without Rae Burrell?
Yes, I mean, I think Tamari Key, she's been on fire. She's been very fun to watch. And honestly, just the way that players continue to step up and continue to answer the call when it's needed, I think that's honestly really impressive to me. They're playing with a chip on their shoulder. They're playing for each other. I think that's a huge difference. Key and Green, she had a really good quote talking about how the buy-in in this team, she had never played on a team that's bought in so early in this season, they're going full force 100%. They're truly giving it their all. If they make mistakes, they're doing everything. They're giving it all. Even if they're making mistakes, they're going to try to then correct it, giving 100% effort, because they want to play for each other and they want to play for this coaching staff. And she said it starts from the top down. It starts from the coaching staff. That love for the players is reciprocated then back, and it shows in their game. They are truly playing for each other.
Well, you and I were talking before we hit record here, and you told me that you'd have a little bit of update on Rae Burrell. So speaking of Rae, what was the update you have?
So it was an update, but maybe not the one that anybody really wants to hear right now, but it's not dire. She said this is the plan. She's been able to progress a little bit more and has been in a few shooting drills with the team, which shows progress, but they don't have a different timeline as of right now. So Kelly said she's working really hard to try to get back to play with the team. But again, this is where I said maybe fans wouldn't like to hear this, because there's no concrete timeline of when she will return to play at this point.
I personally would be happy if she can get back sometime in mid to late January. If you can get back before the UConn game, I'll be happy with that.
Phenomenal.
To me, yeah.
Originally, I thought she was possibly going to be coming back before SEC play. Mm-hmm. But I mean, at this point, I would just like to see her play another time this season.
Yeah, seriously. Well, she has I don't think she's done for the year, but it would be such a shame even if she is done into postseason play, because she's such a fun player to watch. And she had such high potential and high hopes for this year. I mean, she was a preseason, I think she's preseason All-American. She was at least preseason All-SEC. She had all kinds of on watch lists and stuff. She was, poised to, you weren't going to replace Renaya Davis, but she was poised to be, the next person to be the scorer, to be the leader of the team. And, and to Jordan Horson's credit, she's kind of stepped up and has done that this year for the Lady Vols too. It's been this team, the personality of this team, I think, and you've obviously got to experience that more than I have, being at practices and talking to Kelly Harper and talking to the players and stuff. But I think, to me, the personality of these players and these coaches, especially Coach Williams, who does the TikTok stuff.
Love the TikTok.
Yeah, they are very, very, very fun to follow.
Very fun to follow. Very fun to watch. And like you said, I mean, it's been really fun. And that also, I wanted to give another injury update, because Kaya Wynn and Emily Saunders did not play in the last game. And we found out last minute that they weren't going to be available. Kaya is coming back from nose surgery, and then Emily Saunders, she suffered a slight concussion before last week. So Kelly said this week Kaya has been back in practice, and she actually had a really good practice on Tuesday, so they're excited about that. And then Emily Saunders was actually back in practice today for the first time, so she said it will be good to get our full team back. So I'm gonna guess so will be available for Stanford, but that was just in a couple injury update on that too.
Well, speaking of Stanford, this game is going to be huge. I don't know, what last year, with there being COVID restrictions and stuff, there wasn't really a true big game atmosphere. I thought this year's game against Texas, I wasn't at the game, but watching it on TV, it felt very close to some of the big game atmospheres of the Lady Vols, days of yore, of the Pat Summit era. It felt like the atmosphere was loud and passionate. I'm fully expecting, I don't necessarily expect a sellout this weekend, but I'm fully expecting this to be a huge crowd for this Tennessee Stanford game. It's the first top 10 matchup of Kelly Harper's tenure at Tennessee. It's the first top 10 matchup for the Lady Vols. I want to say, I had it right here in front of me.
2018, I think.
Yeah, I think you're right. Yeah, I think since 2018, it's almost 4 years, because I think it was January of 2018. So it's been almost 4 years since the Lady Vols have played in this type of game where you have two top tier opponents. I think this, it's interesting the fact that Stanford is ranked number 3, Lady Vols ranked number 7, because you look at the schedules of both teams, they've played two similar opponents, and Stanford has lost to both of those, and Lady Vols beat them. So I saw a few people on Twitter, Kellyanne, say, "Now wait a minute, how does this add up? Doing the math here, this doesn't add up. Why are Lady Vols ranked lower?" I think Stanford has played a couple other more quality opponents than Lady Vols outside of that, but they lost to Texas and UCF. Yeah. Tennessee beat both those teams. So I understand people saying, "Now wait a minute, where is this math ain't mathing right here?"
the math ain't math. And I love that because I wholeheartedly agree with them, honestly, because yes, Stanford did lose to Southport in Texas. Lady Vols did beat them. Now Stanford comes in running a 3-game win streak, which they did beat number 2 Maryland. Mm-hmm. But still, you look at Tennessee, you're like, okay, well, they're 9-0. They are undefeated. And the only two losses that Stanford had were to teams that Tennessee beat. And I don't know if they're counting, keeping this in their mind, but to me, of course, this team is doing it without their top leading scorer who is returning from last year in Rae Burrell. So I just think, me personally, that's more impressive. But still, all that we just talked about builds up to this excitement of this game. And I'm hoping it's a sellout. I would love to personally, selfishly experience a sold out Lady Vol TBA game, and it should be. This is a super exciting. The team is really excited. Kelly always talks about how excited they are for this one, how they're looking forward to this one. And it's funny about those rankings. She addressed that earlier today. She said she didn't, for her, that really hasn't crossed her mind, but the team is playing with a little bit of a chip on their shoulder that they want to go improve something. So she would like if they would maybe use that as a little bit of, she said she'd try to use that as maybe a little bit of her motivational tactics of reminding them about that, because she wants them to continue to play with that chip on their shoulder. And I want them to too, because like we mentioned before, they're really fun to watch and bring that mentality into this huge Stanford game.
I like that. You know, Kelly Harper specifically said that, because a lot of times coaches, you'll get a lot of coach speak is, oh, we don't care about the polls, doesn't matter. I like that. You know, she said she didn't really care across her mind, but she has reminded her players, which to me makes me think she has thought about it a little bit. You know, that's one thing as a side note. I think I mentioned this to either Cora or Maria Cornelius, who I had on for the first episode of Lady Vol podcast here. I really appreciate the fact that Kelly Harper, in much the same way that Rick Barnes does, you don't get a lot of canned like coach speak answers from her and for him either, but you don't get a lot of like, it is what it is, you know, just kind of repeating lines. Like, she tells it to you straight and she tells you how she feels. She's not like, you know, she's not rude about it. She's never come across as like being snippy or rude or anything like that to me, but I really much appreciate Kelly Harper in an interview setting. She's been one of the fair coaches I ever spoke to when I was still working with RTI. Like, I really enjoyed talking with her. I'm sure you also have.
1000% agree with you on that one, her and Rick. And I'd even throw Tony Vitello. I know it's off
topic.
Baseball, but going back to basketball, yes, Rick and Kelly are phenomenal. And selfishly for TV, I like them a lot too, in terms of their sound bites and what they give you, because it's not just your typical coach speak or whatever you just mentioned. It is straight. It's real. It's coming. It's from the heart. She's just saying what she feels. So I do like that about Kelly as well. That's also what makes covering this team very fun.
Well, back to actually looking at Stanford.
Yes.
They are a team that I think is very dangerous. They have some pretty good offensive players. They returned a lot of their players from the team that won the national championship last year. They went 31-2 overall, and the only two losses they had were in Pac-12 play. But you had a lot of their players that were on early season watch lists, but their leading scorer is last name is Brink. I just forgot her first name. Yeah. Cameron Brink. She's averaging 15 points, 8 boards. That's going to be hard to contend with. You also have Jones and Hull. That is Haley Jones and then Lexi Hull. They're both averaging about 10 points a game. So, you know, I haven't looked too much beyond and look at their depth, but that's a pretty solid trio there that I think the Lady Vols are going to, that, you know, the defense for Lady Vols has been there all year. The only game this year where they, you know, they've really allowed any sort of points was against Texas, but they shut down Texas in the fourth quarter. So, I mean, even that one, like, you look at the defense as a big reason they won that game. So this is going to be, I think, potentially Lady Vol's toughest test on defense this year. And it's going to be a fun one, because Stanford is, they are very good. We know Tara Vanderveer. She's been around for a long time, a really good coach. She's already a Hall of Famer, and she's still an active coach. It's pretty impressive. But no, this Stanford team, I think, is the most deadly offensively that I think Lady Vols have faced this year.
I 100% agree with you. It's going to be a tough test for them on defense and even just trying to get some production themselves on offense. And that's one thing I asked, you know, with Kelly today. It's like, what challenges does Stanford present? Obviously, they present a ton. And it's one of those teams that they're going into it where they cannot make mistakes. They have to play very well. She said, looking at Stanford for her, they're bigger than them, which that person, they have bigger personnel than them. That doesn't happen a lot for the Lady Vols because they have that height. And so she said they pass the ball extremely well. So of course they have to be strong on defense. You can't goof on defense, if you do, she said, you know, they're going to take advantage of it. You can't make mistakes against the Stanford team. And they really, in terms of offensively, they like to score on the inside. So defending on the inside is going to be important from them. Should see a lot of production, of course, continued production from Tamari Key. She's got to stay out of foul trouble though. And so she said defensively for Stanford, they will just expose your weaknesses and then just go run with it. So they're going to be tough. She said, they have to play really, really well. The team knows they have to play really, really well, but they're just overall excited to be playing in this opportunity.
I can't make
any mistakes against the Stanford team.
Oh no, absolutely not. And I know the Lady Vols, they've done a better job in, you know, since Kelly Harper's gotten there, cutting down on turnovers kind of each year. I think that's a big key in this game. You can't have a lot of unforced errors. If Stanford, you know, steals the ball and causes you to give it up, okay, don't let it happen too often, but that's going to happen. Don't make a lot of bad passes. Right. And that's been a thing, is bad passes have bitten Lady Vols. That obviously hasn't caused them to lose yet, but it's been an issue sometimes.
Right.
And the free throws, like that, those are two areas that concern me. I think I probably know your answer on this one, because it might be the same one I have, but who is, for the Lady Vols, who's someone you're circling in this game that you think needs to really perform? Because to me, I think it's possibly your answer too, is Tamari Key, and or maybe even Alexis Dye, because I think, or maybe or even Key and Green, but I really think Tamari Key to me is like the
Tamari Key is the key.
Yeah, she's the key.
Mm-hmm. Let's have another double double. Come on, she can do it. She's been killing it.
Hey, let's get another triple double. Why not?
The triple double, because Tamari Key, she is key on both ends of the court. She's gonna be really key in this one too, especially on defense. I like the Alexis Dye. When she gets that jumper, that good jump shot she has, she gets it. She can light it up. She is a shooter. She just has to find that chemistry and get it going, and that energy to, or the flow, I should say, on offense to light it up. So she will be one to watch too. And I Jordan Horson, she just has to do her thing. She just has to be a shooter. She's a shooter. She's got to do that. She's got to stay out of foul trouble. She's got to limit those turnovers. She knows better. She's playing at a higher level this year. She really needs to light it up. And the one thing about this matchup too, I thought about, is there have been times this season where they've continued to still be the cardiac kids. Well, they'll be down. They'll be down, but they pulled it off. They always pull it off. They pulled it off in the fourth quarter. So even in going to this game, because it is going to be very challenging, even if they're trailing at halftime, even if they're trailing after third quarter, I would not count this team out. They've proven that they can rise to the challenge and they can overcome. So they even had that a huge overtime win. And at Jordan Horston, she's really good, I feel like, under pressure, because I feel like she can pull it off in the fourth quarter and she can answer when they need to. She's done that where she becomes the clutch player. She also needs to do that. Another person I think is also key to watch is Sarah Puckett. Sarah Puckett's playing very well for a freshman, and mm-hmm. she has also stepped up numerous times this season in the fourth quarter and shown that she can also be that clutch, that player in the clutch time.
I think it's a good point, and one that I meant to bring up earlier and kind of forgot when we were talking about things that have been most impressive for this team this year. The last, you know, year, couple years of the Holly Warlick era, and even early on in Kelly Harper's tenure, it seemed like to me, like, especially in big games against really good opponents, the third quarter would be the nail in the coffin for Lady Vols. They'd have a bad third quarter and they couldn't recover in the fourth. This year, when they've had, you know, not great third quarters, look at the Texas game. They, like you said, they're the cardiac kids. They've come back in the fourth. And that's like you said, I'm not going to, if Lady Vols are even down by double digits going into the fourth quarter, I'm not counting them out. Right. This year, you can't, because they've shown multiple times they've gone down by 10, they've gone down by 8, 9, 12 points in the third quarter, and then come back in the fourth and won it. So that's a really good point. That's what I meant to bring up earlier, that, you know, this team doesn't quit. And I think that's not something you could have said in the last 3 or 4 years about Lady Vols. And I guess last year you saw it kind of building where they, you know, they didn't quit last year either. But this team this year specifically, I mean, there is no quit in this team. They're going to fight and grind their way to whatever they need to do. There was something, go ahead.
Yeah, they're just, like I mentioned earlier, they're just truly fighting for each other. And you can see that. And it's fun. And it's exciting.
This is the most fun I've had watching Lady Vols in a while. And it feels really nice to say that, because it's been like, I had fun last year in some games, and obviously when they beat, you know, Texas A&M, that was a lot of fun. Nice. But and when they played Notre Dame, that was fun too. But there's been, like, it's been a while since I've had this much, like, entertainment, getting excited, like fist pumping and yelling when I'm on my couch watching the Lady Vols play. It's been a lot of fun to watch them this year. To go back to the Stanford game really quickly, looking at Stanford and you know, the Lady Vols just played on a week ago on Sunday. So they've had a little bit of a break, and they had a break before. Like there's a week they played on Sunday, week off, played Sunday. Now they're going to play on Saturday. So they have a little bit of a, you know, a break there and kind of time to, like you said, mention heal up for a couple of players like Kai Wynn and Emily Saunders. Stanford, meanwhile, they played, I think, on Wednesday, and then they're having to make the trip all the way from the West Coast all the way over here to Knoxville. Yep. And it's going to be, I think, a really loud and passionate environment there in Thompson Bowling. I wonder how much that's going to play into it, because that's we saw from, you know, the men's team when they went over to Colorado and had to turn around really quickly and play Texas Tech in New York. Like that is not a short plane, flight. And I mean, and Stanford getting here, I guess they probably would have gotten here. I guess they're here now at this point, but like that's adjusting from West Coast, you know, the Pacific time to Eastern Standard Time. You're 3 hours ahead all of a sudden from what your usual schedule is. It's like, I wonder how much that's going to play into, you know, people, that's the thing that people don't think about. They think of it, like, to me, I think a lot of people think of sports and like video game terms where these, you know, these are just players, you know, they have these certain inputs here and you don't factor in the fact they're humans and you do get jet lagged and you do feel different when you travel on a short time
and everything.
Yeah. So I really wonder how much that's really going to play into like this game, because I think, again, they're all human. So how much is that going to affect Stanford and their players of, you know, do they come out flat? Do they come out, you know, and, you know, their jump shots doesn't have much power behind them. Are they hitting the rim? Are they hitting the backboard and nothing else? Like how much is that going to affect, you know, are they going to have tired and lead laden legs? There we go. That was a tongue twister. But that's something I'm kind of watching that I'd be interested to see how Stanford starts this game.
I think that's a good point. Now, even to that point, it'd be interesting to see how they would finish the game, because they could also come out strong, but then not be able to sustain the same kind of power and energy if Tennessee is really wearing them down, especially if they are at a deficit after the half, or like, you know, Tennessee has a deficit, Stanford has lead. Tennessee has had this week off to rest. You know, it's interesting though. I feel like rest and that week off could also sometimes be a double-edged sword for athletes, because last week we saw that Tennessee was a little bit rusty going into the Georgia State game, but they also had finals that they were dealing with, where now they're past that, to where they're on break and they can just truly be like professional athletes in terms of they're just in the gym, they're gym rats. That's really only their focus right now. I mean, outside of other personal things, but looking at it as that way, they're in the gym all the time. They're practicing. Like I said, this is their sole focus. So that can, and to heal, rest and recover. So that can definitely be a huge advantage for Tennessee. But like I said, it could be a double-edged sword, because they could come out a little bit lackadaisical and rusty. I think more so with Georgia State, that was because of finals and all the other stresses that do come with being a student and a student athlete. But yeah, I think that's an interesting point and something to watch in terms of, will that play to Tennessee's advantage with Stanford being so taxed heading into this one?
If Tennessee wins this game, they have ETSU and Chattanooga left on their non-conference schedule before starting SEC play on December 30th against Alabama, which I think is interesting. Both the men's and women's teams begin SEC play against Alabama. But if they win this game, I mean, I don't see a way that ETSU and Chattanooga sneaks up and beats Lady Vols. It would be phenomenal for Lady Vols to get through this non-conference schedule they had undefeated starting SEC play. That would be phenomenal.
And I'm right there with you. I really don't see if they pull this off. I just really don't see Chat or the other one. I can't remember the one.
ETSU.
Thank you. Mm-hmm. Pulling off the upset. I think they would roll right into SEC play undefeated, which is massive.
Like I genuinely, when we were looking at the,
I'm surprised.
Yeah. The season beforehand, when Gene and I were making our predictions for both the men's and women's teams, like we looked at, I mean, both teams have pretty difficult non-conference schedules. We're thinking, man, Lady Vols have an even more difficult one than the men's team does. And here we go. Men's team has two losses. Lady Vols have zero. And again, without Rae Burrell, like that's the crazy thing.
And this team is so impressive. And Kelly has talked about that multiple times before, is that they want to be playing this tough non-conference schedule. That is the point. That is why they are the Lady Vols. That's why they come to play for Tennessee. They want that tough non-conference schedule to be able to set them up for conference play and beyond. So we can see if they'll actually reap the rewards of that. And like you mentioned, the men have two losses, the women's have none, and they're without Rae Burrell. So it's honestly truly impressive, in my opinion.
Before we end the show here, I want to look ahead even further. Mm-hmm. Obviously, there's going to be a lot of fun SEC matchups for the Lady Vols. You know, looking at A&M, looking at South Carolina, looking at even like Arkansas has been a sneaky good team for the last few years in women's sports or women's basketball too. But you know where I'm going to go here. February 6th against UConn, because
UConn.
I cannot wait for that game. As pumped as I am for this weekend's game against Stanford, because that's a team that Tennessee has played a lot. I think this is like their 37th or 38th time playing each other. And obviously Stanford's been really good for a very long time under Tara Vanderveer. UConn to me, like, that's obviously the biggest rival for Lady Vols. The fact that Paige Beckers, that to me is going to be interesting, because she just had the surgery, and I'm looking at a headline here from the New York Times that said she's going to miss at least 8 weeks. That would put her out for the Lady Vols game. And as much as I would love to see the Lady Vols play UConn at their peak, with a full healthy roster, I'm not gonna lie, and I like Paige, like she's a really good player, and I like her as a person, but like, I'm not gonna lie, like I kind of don't mind the fact that she might miss Lady Vols game. I'm not gonna lie.
I mean, listen, sending positive vibes, wish her nothing but the best. I also want her to recover, because she is truly an unreal talent, and she is fun to watch. But I'm with you, so selfishly covering the Lady Vols, it would be great if she wasn't back. And like you mentioned with that headline, because I remember reading, I saw the month or 8 weeks, I should say. So what, 2 months at least. And rehab is different for everybody. Mm-hmm. It just depends on how your body is able to recover. Everybody's truly different. So yeah, that could easily be longer. But like you mentioned, that would put her out for the Tennessee game. That'd be a really good advantage. And it'd also be a really good advantage if they would get Rae Burrell back by that time too.
Yeah, I mean, could you imagine if Lady Vols have had Rae Burrell back for a couple weeks by that point? Yeah. Paige Beckers is out. Like, I've said this before.
Rae Burrell coming back too, if she is fully healthy, she's going to be one out of the gate. You could tell she does not like missing this time. No athlete does. Mm-hmm. So she will be ready to go, ripe, excited, out of the gate. So that could be fun too.
I will say, since you brought Rae back up, has she been allowed to talk to the media since she's been out?
No.
Okay, I didn't think so. I figured probably not, since most injured players don't talk to the media. So I didn't think so, because I was curious like what her, I know you saw her at practice, like I was curious like how she's carrying herself and her demeanor is when she's on the court out there, when she's practicing with her teammates.
So today we only got, of course, a short glimpse of it. Mm-hmm. And she, I was mostly paying attention to the action, because I was also shooting the practice action on the court. But I saw her coming down from Thompson Bowling Arena, like she's coming down the stairs, and then she sat down and she was just sitting. And I remember, and I could just be reading her wrong, but just reading from me looking on the outside in, this specific moment when she, against the Georgia State game, I saw her and did a cutaway of her on the bench, and she just looked upset. I don't know. She just looked like, you know, she wants to be out there playing. And Kelly said one thing too, is that she's accepting this current new role of trying to be that cheerleader, trying to be that leader, that voice on the team of guidance. It's hard for an athlete to stay engaged into what's happening when they're not physically out there doing it with everybody and a part of the game plan. So especially if you have an indefinite timeline, I could imagine that's pretty hard.
Yeah, I feel like it is one thing. Like if you're Paige Beckers and you have a timeline of, okay, I know that it's going to be probably 2 months or so. Like you kind of have a deadline in your head of, okay, this is kind of when I'm gonna come back. But with Rae, when it's, you know, maybe they've given her more of a timeline behind the scenes and not made it public, but like you said, right, we don't know. But it seems though that like there is a very much more indefinite timeline, and she doesn't know when she's gonna come back, because who knows the healing process with ankles and legs and stuff, man. That it varies, as you said earlier, it varies between people. Like it one person can heal really quickly. You look at, you know, Amari Rodgers, for example, like he healed, and what he did to get back as quickly as he did, it was very impressive. But then some guys, you don't go back to basketball, like guys like Greg Oden, just get hurt and can't stay healthy, and they can't get back to what, you know, they were before. So hopefully, I just want Rae to get out. I don't care when she comes back. I just want her to get healthy, and when she comes back, you know, not re-aggravate something and not re-injure herself.
And I think that's key too, because you never want to push it. You want to make sure you are full good to go, because you don't want to be injury prone then for the rest of your career. And she set herself up for what projected to be, you know, a good WNBA career, a good pro career. And I would love nothing more than to see her playing at the highest level. So, but yeah, right now I can't imagine that would be, though, back to our point of it being pretty tough right now to take that back seat and take on this new role, something that you're not used to.
And I do want to say here, and as we're closing the show, we mentioned it, Gina and I did at the very tail end of our podcast. A lot of people probably didn't hear it, but I want to say here now on the Lay of All podcast too, big congratulations to Candace Parker and the fact that she and her wife are going to have a child, another child. Layla's going to be a big sister. Like, that's really exciting. That's really cool.
And that was awesome news. It's such heartwarming news. And yeah, it's awesome. I think Cora shared a video of Layla doing the dance or the TikTok dance. And it helped doing that. She's like, oh, she's gonna be such a great big sister. So it's so exciting. I can't wait to see that family grow and continue to grow.
Yeah, last time I had Cora on, it was shortly after she'd actually interviewed Layla and just had her on camera. And I was like, it's hard to believe she's a, for one, because of her height, that she's a 12-year-old, but two, like, she composed herself for a 12-year-old. She already seems very media savvy. Like, you can tell that she's her mother's daughter. Like, she just comes across like as confident in front of a camera as Candace does. Like, it's really impressive.
I'm sure she's seen her mother too numerous times interviews left and right, so I'm sure she's kind of picked up on some tips and some cues from even just watching her mom.
And then staying on the Candace Parker train, there's been so many, I saw Maria put a video out and pictures out of, you know, different things going on with Layla following Candace around when she was a little kid with Layla and Pat Summit and stuff. There's just been a lot of really, like, touching, for whatever reason, I don't even know why it started happening this past week. There's been a lot of touching moments on Twitter and stuff this past week of videos of Candace and Layla and with Pat and just different stuff from their Tennessee days. And I'm just like, I don't know why y'all are trying to sit here and make me cry all the time on social media, but here we are, I guess.
Why am I in my feels all of a sudden? Oh, my timeline. I'm right there with you. Yeah. Cause you know, I follow Maria too. So I really enjoy the content she shares as well. And what her content herself too, she creates, but I've noticed that too. And I was like, I wonder why that's being brought up now. Am I missing something? But I'm just going to take it as a heartwarming token. And something, like you said, is also getting me in my feels.
Well, Kelly, it's been an absolute pleasure having you on the show. We're definitely going to have you back. I'm glad to go behind the scenes a little bit here. Kellyanne, I've been trying to do this for months, trying to get her to come on here to help me out with the show and do stuff. And finally, we got to work.
Oh, man. So,
very glad you were finally able to come on here. Let everybody who's listening / watching this, if you're watching this, I've probably already put it on the screen in different places. You can follow Kellyanne, but obviously you're on TV with WAT6. But let everyone know where they can follow you and find a lot of the really cool video work you do.
You can follow me on Twitter at Kellyanne Stitts. You can follow me on Instagram, on Facebook. I have a professional page, Kellyanne Stitts. That's where I put a lot of my content. I also am kind of active on YouTube. But if you're interested in some of our work, whether it's covering the Lady Vols, Tennessee basketball, baseball, of course, Tennessee football, and even just what's happening locally with our high school teams and just keeping up with our LVFLs, VFLs, all the sorts. Yeah, feel free to follow and hopefully you enjoy the content that I put out there. And also, it's been such a blast. I know like you mentioned, we've been trying to set this up for so long. So it's been so fun finally hopping on the pod with you.
Yeah, it has been fun. This being our first actual like video podcast too. So again, hopefully a lot of you all who listened to this on audio heard my cue at the beginning and said, oh, there's a video. I'm going to watch it on YouTube because I'm very excited to do more video content here for both Vol basketball and Lady Vol basketball fever. But thank you all so much for listening or watching, you know, wherever you are. Subscribe to us, like the video, like our Facebook page, leave us reviews, all that stuff they always tell you to do. Smash the like button. I'm going to start having to do YouTube talk now. That's going to be interesting. But thank you all so much, genuinely. I really appreciate all of you. You guys are fantastic. We've had such support here on both the shows. So we really appreciate that. And as the year is closing out, I just want to say thank you to all of you for making 2021 a great year for us. So signing off for Kellyanne, I'm Nathaniel. This has been another episode of the Lady Vol Basketball Fever Podcast. Thank you for listening to the Vol Basketball Fever Podcast. Subscribe to the show so you'll never miss another episode.